Mama Bet, I tell you, study. Once upon a time, long ago and far away, there lived a woman named Ifrigia. Ifrigia was so beautiful that the heavens claimed her as a daughter, and Father Sky took her as a wife. In time, Ifrigia became the favorite wife of Father Sky, and together they had many children, each one more beautiful than the next. Ifrigia was a good mother. Every night she would sing her children to sleep with a lilting lullaby, and every day she would wake them with a sweet morning song. One day, Father Sky and Ifrigia, they quarrel. That night, Ifrigia refused to go to his bed, which made Father Sky very angry. The following day, Ifrigia go to sing her morning song. The children gone, disappear. So, every night, Ifrigia searched the great Father Sky, looking for a son, looking for an omen, and she asked, where are my children? Where have they gone? Who has stolen them? And Father Sky, sorry for what he has done, opens up! And cries bitter tears, which run down the face of all the gods and fall on Mother Earth. In the rain tears, there are many voices. The voices say, look to the ground, and there, in the divine mud, Ifrigia finds her answer. Here are my children, kidnapped to a strange land. Here is the footprint of my children. Smell it. Taste it. Remember it. Bless it. Ashanti, Maasai, Dinka, Kikuyu, Yoruba, Tuareg, Bobo, Falasha, Swahili, Zulu, Iwe, Ga, Haiti, America, Douglas, Frederick, Augustus, Washington, Bailey, Douglas. Because of Frederick Douglass, the children of Ifrigia can grow in a place where the ancestors can see them. I dance for the stolen children. I dance for Ifrigia. I dance for America. I dance for Frederick Douglass. Thank you.
Thank you.
My master's house is in walking distance of the Chesapeake Bay, which is wide with sails from ships from every corner of the world. These beautiful white vessels remind me of ghosts, and they terrify and torment me with thoughts of my own wretched condition. Every Sunday I have freedom. I stand on the banks of this bay and trace the countless numbers of white sails moving off to the mighty ocean. And with no audience but the Almighty, I pour out my soul's complaint. You are loose from your moorings and are free. I am fast in my chains and am a slave. You move before the gentle gale and I before the bloody whip. You fly around the world. I am confined in bands of iron. Oh, that I were free. If I could but swim. If I could fly. Go on,
Go on.
Oh, that I could also go. The ship is gone, and I'm left here. Oh, God, save me. God, deliver me. Let me be free. Why am I a slave? Is there any God? I cannot live and die a slave. I will not stand it. I will run away. Yes, God helping me, I will run away. I know I can make it. I am not the only slave in the world. I can bear as much as any of you. Maybe my misery and slavery will only increase my happiness when I get free. And I will be free. When you wish upon a star, makes no difference who you are. Anything your heart desires will come to you. If your heart is in your dream, no request is too extreme. When you wish upon a star, as dreamers do, fate is kind. She brings to those who a sweet fulfillment of their secret longing. Like a bolt out of the blue, fate steps in and sees you through. When you wish upon a star, your dreams come true. Take a good long look at me and behold a man transformed into a slave. Because the next time you see Frederick Augustus Washington Bailey, you will see a slave transformed into a man. Thank you.
call me J.B. No, not James Brown. James Baldwin, the godmother of soul. Ow. And I do not feel good. Mother Popcorn has broken out into a very cold sweat and is in dire need of a brand new bag. I feel a Cassandra moment coming on. I don't know. Call it a gift. But I sense that some of you are wondering whether whiskey-soaked, nicotine-addicted, homosexual expatriate is doing in a narrative about Frederick Douglass. Well, I'm here to provide you with a perspective. Think of me as Apollo's oracle at Adelphi, a griot, a living library, a prophet. Now, you do understand that prophets are never honored and are even very seldom welcomed in their own time. They're either killed or forgotten. And then you name a street after them. Any of you ever see a James Baldwin Boulevard? Anywhere? Never mind. Back to the other J.B. Because just like the Godfather, Mother Popcorn is going to take you to the bridge and drop you into some funk that's so deep it's going to make you want to holler, throw up both your hands. Are you ready?
Yes.
I cannot hear you. Yes. Oh, no, 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 no. Are you ready?
Yes.
Right, let's go. It's 1968, January 31st. The year begins with the Tet Offensive, a military operation by the North Vietnamese that stuns the Johnson White House and the American people into finally thinking, maybe this war we're fighting just isn't winnable. To add to his troubles, LBJ, in what was supposed to have been a private conversation in the Oval Office, refers to Martin Luther King as that nigger preacher. Ah! Well, by the end of 1968, Johnson is so unpopular, it is impossible for him to be reelected. April 3rd, Mason Temple, a Pentecostal church in Memphis, Tennessee. Martin delivers a fiery speech in support of the striking sanitation workers. I'm delighted to see each of you here tonight in spite of a storm warning. You reveal that you are determined to go on. As you know, something is happening in our world. Well, if I was standing at the beginning of time with the possibility of a general and panoramic view of the whole human history up to now, and the Almighty said to me, Martin Luther King, which age would you like to live in? I would turn to the Almighty and say, if you will allow me to live just a few years in the second half of the 20th century, I will be happy. Well, I don't know what's gonna happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead. But it don't matter to me now, because I've been to the mountaintop, and I don't mind. Like anyone, I would like to live a long time. Longevity has its place, but I'm not concerned with that now. I just want to do God's will, and He's allowed me to go up to the mountain, and I've looked over, and I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know as a people, tonight we will get to the promised land. And I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. And I see God working in this period of the 20th century in a way that men are responding to. Something is happening in our world. The masses are rising up, and wherever they are assembled, whether they are in Johannesburg, South Africa, Nairobi, Kenya, Accra, Ghana, New York City, Atlanta, Georgia, Jackson, Mississippi, or Memphis, Tennessee, the cry is always the same. We want to be free! Shackles from his wrist, and he will continue to struggle against the phantom weight of his bondage. You might remove the fetters from his ankles and feet, but he will go on shuffling haltingly as if still caught in some invisible restraint. But let that same man lose the chains from his mind. Those of you who are fortunate enough to live in the generations beyond the curse of slavery, take note of your young black brethren as they go to and fro. Still wearing that ball and chain, still waiting for the revolution to be televised. The African in North America, the so-called Negro, has endured for nearly 300 years unspeakable crimes against his body, against his spirit, against his mind. In spite of that, in order to continue to survive, no. In order to thrive, and yet again, no! In order to prevail, the African American must learn these indispensable lessons. He must learn how to read. He must learn how to write. He must learn how to be free. He must learn how to fight. Now, you all can celebrate having acquired such skills. But for a slave, being enlightened was punishable by death, because the slave owner believes, and correctly so, that an enlightened slave is a dangerous slave. Rise, my brethren. Rise up from your knees. Cleanse from your mind the white man's vision of bondage and replace it with the black man's dream of freedom. Rise above oppression. Rise above race. Rise above yourselves and triumph over life. For 26 years I prayed on my knees and received no answer until I prayed with my legs. Rise up and walk! If there is no struggle, there is no progress. Those who profess to favor freedom and deprecate agitation are men who want crops without plowing up the ground. They want rain without thunder and lightning. It is not the gentle shower that we need, but the thunder. We need the storm. We need the whirlwind. We need the earthquake. And then maybe once and for all, mankind will learn this indisputable lesson that where justice is denied, where poverty is enforced, where ignorance prevails, and where any one class of people is made to feel that society is an organized conspiracy to oppress, rob, and degrade them, neither persons nor property will be safe. Strength of body and will is necessary to sustain life. The purpose of life is never found. It must be created. There is no liberation without literacy. Freedom without literacy is still bondage. This is the Holy Scripture. It is how I learned to read. I have read it many times from cover to cover, and I come away with this irrevocable belief that the Almighty helps those that help themselves. This is the Columbian Orator, containing original and selected pieces, along with rules calculated to improve youth and others in the ornamental and useful art of eloquence. It is how I learned to write. Mr. Abraham Lincoln and his Emancipation Proclamation is how I learned to be free. Every slave has a great white father, either in the woodpile or the big house, or in history's file or the White House. And this is how I learned to fight. I was somewhat unmanageable as a young slave, especially during my teenage years. To better control me, my master sent me to live with a Mr. Edward Covey. Now, Mr. Covey had acquired a very high reputation as a nigger breaker, and his reputation was of immense value to him. On our very first meeting, he gave me a severe whipping, cutting my back and causing blood to run, raising ridges on my flesh as large as my fingers. I lived with Mr. Covey for 1 year, during which time scarcely a week passed that he did not whip me. Oh, yes. Mr. Covey succeeded in breaking me. I was broken in body, in soul, spirit, but he did not break my mind. Eventually, on one of the hottest days in August, Mr. Covey, with no provocation, came after me, cracking that vicious black leather snake of his. He raised that lash high in the air, revealing a countenance so treacherous that it made my blood run cold. It was a moment that moved monstrously slowly, as if frozen in time. And then, just as sure as if the lash had connected with my flesh, there was this unmistakable sound of something snapping. Now, out of servile habit, I would have turned to see if some accident had occurred nearby, but in my heart of hearts, I knew what had happened. Something had snapped inside of Mr. Covey. His fury was so great that I knew in my young bones he was determined to kill me. And whence the spirit came, I do not know, but I resolved to fight. Slave or no slave, I seized Mr. Covey hard by the throat. My resistance was so entirely unexpected that it took him all aback. He was trembling like a leaf. Never before that moment, and at no time since, have I been so confident that God's mysterious power was on my side. I was determined to have my freedom or die. I seized Mr. Covey hard by the collar and with a sudden snatch brought him to the ground. Ow! Ow! We were at it for nearly 2 hours. I considered him as entirely getting the worst of the bargain, for he drew no blood from me, but I had from him. I have never felt like this before in my life. And from that moment on, I did not hesitate to let it be known that the white man who expected to succeed in whipping me must also succeed in killing me. No man can put a chain about the ankle of his fellow man without at last finding the other end fast about his own neck. And for the first time in my life, I could see beyond tomorrow. I could see to a future time, a time when other men, men like me, would experience love, truth, and justice. I could see a glad day of deliverance. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He has loosed his faithful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on in of the lily. Christ was born across the sea with the glory in his bosom that transfigures you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us die to make men free. While God is marching on, glory, glory, hallelujah, glory, glory, hallelujah, glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on. And so it shall be at the end of the world. The angels shall come forth and sever the wicked from amongst the just. And then Jesus asked of his disciples, have you understood all this? And the disciples answered, yes. Robert, before we fade black, I would just like to take a moment and thank all of my friends, old and new, for coming out this afternoon and witnessing this work in progress. As you were. As you've probably figured out by now, it is also a life in progress. Ever since I was a young boy, I have dreamed of nothing but this. The whole world is a stage, and I'm the main attraction. It was my fondest wish to have, to experience theater as a way of life. And I've been very blessed to achieve exactly that. Theater as a way of life. Only to discover how finite that can be. So now, as a mature actor, looking like a black Abraham Lincoln wearing a yarmulke, I pursue theater as a way to life. And there's a subtle difference. One is a goal, the other is a mission. And it has been my mission with these performances to remind us all that we do indeed live in apocalyptic times, but so does every generation. It's the universe's way of reminding us that we still have time to make a choice. And I figured it out this way. We can either choose to make a contribution to what I call the big sleep, or we can make our contribution to what I like to refer to as the great awakening. I'm sort of hanging on this side. And I encourage all of you and wish you well in whatever choice or decision that you make. But one thing I'm confident about, something that we can do together, and that is we can lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. If you know it, sing it with me. Ring with the harmony of liberty, let our rejoicing Let it resound loud as the rolling sea.
Bring it from here.
Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of a new day begun, let us march on till victory is won. Just like that.
Thank you.